Now we will have a short theoretical part. We will talk about the structure of the film, how to structure the film. And we will talk about script. And first of all, I need to warn you that script writing is something that more relates to fiction films. All fiction films start with the story, start with the script, and then people work a lot on polishing it, on making it perfect, and then it goes to actual shooting, and then people follow the script. In documentary, the situation is different. As you know, most of the time it's the life which directs the story, which directs the situation, and which directs your film. However, still it is important to know the basics of script writing, and also it is a very good exercise on different stages of your film to think about the script, to think how you will structure the film. For example, yesterday you already presented some structures which you have. This structure you made based on your preliminary research. Then it's also very good exercise to continue this after, you know, like you have a first day of shooting, maybe something changed. You have 1 month of shooting, maybe some other things came up, maybe things that you thought were important, they're not important anymore, but other things fit to the story more, or you change your story. So basically the script writing in documentary, I would say like this, is formed on the stage of the editing. In the editing, you decide what your film will be, and not so much during the shooting. So this is the basic three-act structure. It is like a prototype which you will find in every book which deals with the script writing, and it's like the structure which all Hollywood script writers use. And again, like it's more for the fiction films, but you need to think how it will work for your documentary. It is actually it's very old structure. First, it was described in the 3rd century before Christ by Aristotle in his book Poetics, and there he describes the basis of Greek drama. And actually, every Greek drama and every Hollywood films follow this structure, and it works. So the first act is setup. Setup is the part of the film where we kind of get the idea of the story. Who is the main character? What is the situation? Where she or he is living? What are the relations with the family, with the neighbors, with the people at work, with the people which surround? And what is kind of, we get the sense what the story will be, what is kind of the problem of the main character. Second act is it's called the confrontation, and in this part of the film, the character faces some obstacles, some problems. Character has some need, that some goal that they need to achieve, something, I don't know, they must, for example, in a case of a film about Oksana, the choir conductor, she must provide for her daughter, to make a good future for her daughter. So this is her goal. And what kind of confrontation does she meet? She is away from daughter, and it's not so easy to do it either in Ukraine or in Portugal. So the confrontation part, it describes which obstacles the character meets and how she or he will deal with them. And the last third act is the resolution, how the story is resolved. It doesn't really mean the ending of the story, but it's kind of like how the conflict ends up in terms of, for example, does Tanya stay home or does she go to war? Does someone, you know, find the true love or not? Does someone manage to return safe from a journey or not? So so these are the three main acts, and as you see, it's built in a sort of like a triangle. It goes up and it goes down. down, and this is called, in terms of script writing, it's called a dramatic arc, and how your emotions, how the drama evolves. And within this structure, there are also these, you can see these two red dots. These are called the plot points. Plot points is a situation which kind of moves the story from one act to another. Most of the time it is provoked by a decision, by something which your character does. For example, let's talk on like specific cases so that it is more understandable. My film about the mother and the daughter. So you see the setup, we see how she goes to work, how she is working. We know through the narration what is her situation. The plot point, the first plot point, when sort of we get to know what is her conflict, what is her drama, is when she invites her daughter. So this is, we get to know what's her goal in life. She wants to keep up the relationship with the daughter, and also she wants to, you know, to make her happy, to provide a good future for the daughter. And then we see how she's struggling with this, that she cannot really, you know, do the work she enjoys. She cannot work with the music. She does this as a hobby, but she must clean other people's houses. This second plot point in this particular film, I think it will be when the daughter, when she decides to go back to Ukraine. It's in the very end, she says, I go back. Okay, I'm fed up with this life. I want to, you know, to go back and forget about Portugal. And then the resolution of the film is that her daughter persuaded her to stay in Portugal and continue her life. So this is the example of this film. So this it's very good if your character is active when she does things, when she has a very strong position. It's not like things happen to her. But she decides, she makes a decision. She made a decision to invite her daughter, and she made this decision eventually to stay, although it was, you know, she was asked by her daughter. Let's maybe take another film. I don't know, like I was thinking what example we could talk about. Let's talk about Titanic. I think everyone watched Titanic. So does someone have an idea what could be this act one, confrontation? Resolution. I know that we watched it quite long ago, but I'm sure that everyone watched it. Any ideas, any comments?
I guess an event or decision that begins the story from, well, setup is that there is Titanic and there are like all different classes of people, they're traveling, mm-hmm. and there is this girl, a guy and a girl, and they're from different classes, and then they fall in love, which is, I guess, a decision that begins a story, which it's obvious that it's something unusual that they fall in love, I guess. Should I continue?
Yes. Oh, okay. Go on. Like if you can fill up all the gaps.
It's obvious that the change of events is, I guess, the crash with an iceberg, and then the resolution, and then there's, well, the rise of it is, like, goes on when they're trying to save the ship.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then descending action is, I guess, when they get on, like, they're like drifting on this piece of wood, and then he's dying and she's alive, and that's the resolution, I guess.
Okay, yeah, like it's, I think you are very close to truth, and maybe it is the truth. Maybe I would, there was some other idea, no? Like you wanted to, yeah. Sorry for such a, you know, cheesy example, but we all can relate.
Yeah, I think the story begins where Jack, yeah?
Jack and Rose. Jack.
Mm-hmm. he won a ticket to Titanic, and that event or decisions that begins the story proper, I think. The whole story.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. And I think maybe here is not one clear solution, and both your versions are good. Maybe if we talk from the perspective of two characters, like the story as a whole, and you talk from the perspective of one character, although maybe it's closer to this side because it's, you know, like a love story, so we have two characters, but both this could be, you know, it's you can analyze this film in such a way. Maybe I would summarize and like propose something which would include both of these versions. So yes, like so this setup is the ticket that he won, and the journey begins. People are saying goodbye. They're going to America to see the beautiful life. And since it is a love story, we would agree that it's a love story, right? So the first plot point is then this, you know, is then when Rose is fed up with this high class, with her family, with all these rules that you need to stay with this strange guy, and she decides, okay, I'm fed up, I want to commit suicide, and I will jump off this ship to end this. And then Jack helps her, like he hugs her and all this, and this is the event which then results in the second act. Although it is called confrontation, maybe in this case it's not that much of confrontation, it's more like the whole part of the love story, like, you know, when they're meeting in secret, and then she has these conflicts with her parents, with this guy whom she was supposed to marry. And the second plot point is, yes, this it starts with the ship crash, and the decision of Rose to not to go on this boat, but to stay with Jack. Mm-hmm. Remember, we continue on this track of love story. So we're kind of concentrating these plot points around both characters, around their relationship. So she decides to stay with him, and like to face these waves, the ocean, and the resolution is that this part when they are trying to survive and he dies, she survives. So, but I think it's very useful exercise. You can, you know, like watch other films and see if they have something similar, some structure. Maybe this could be, you know, like not so direct as in Titanic and other Hollywood films, because it's like, you know, this is how they are taught to write. And the scriptwriters have a lot of courses on this structure and how to develop a character. But you can analyze, and also for your film, would there be a dramatic arc? What would be these events? I know it's not so easy for documentary films, but it's absolutely possible. You know, even without the this film about Lenin. You know, like it's very simple. They build it. They crash it, and there is a kind of resolution that loops the end to beginning, and it's like an eternal cycle. Also, I wanted to tell a couple words about beginning and end. What would be like the best beginning and the best end? I think, like from my experience, I very like these cyclical stories. You know, like that. For example, also with Oksana and her daughter. It starts with the train, it ends with the train, and she goes again. You know, like there will be another day, she will again go to work, she will again have these doubts to stay or to leave, and again, like her daughter will continue her career. And the thing, if you want to think of beginning and end, you need to, for beginning, you already need to imagine what the end will be, you know. And for ending, you need to know what your beginning will be. So it's kind of like this Chinese proverb that a journey within a million miles starts with little steps. From the very beginning, you already kind of give a hint for the viewers what could be the possible resolution. It's from my experience, it's just an idea that you can use. Sorry, I have this device. Also, what I find very useful, even for documentaries, is a storyboard. This you can see is from for Hitchcock film The Birds, and you can see that it's very very precise and very like every instance has its own picture. And of course, like people do very sophisticated animation first, you know, like people who can draw. And then you can see it, okay, there's a middle shot or a close up, there are birds flying, and it's, you know, like it's based on the script. It's very simple and direct. But it also works for documentaries. What I usually do, because I am not a good painter, so I just, you know, like imagine storyboards in the scenes. I take these sticky notes, you know, like these papers that you can stick on something, so that you can take them out and move to another place. So, I, for example, I have the scene like Oksana in the church, Oksana and daughter at home, Oksana is traveling on a train. And then think of the film as a whole in the very beginning, it's very complicated, even for small things. For small films, it's like you just get too many ideas, you don't know how to structure, it's very difficult. So start editing with little scenes, like excursion, you know, like, or watching a film. And the discussion of the film. And then so you draw or you just can write, you know, like a discussion, excursion, trip, something else. And then you take these papers and you can, you know, like put them on the board or put them anywhere and you try to rearrange. You take this note, you put it in the end, put this in the beginning, you try to mix and to see, not exactly maybe on the editing software, but just to try to think how the story will evolve if you change direction, or how to say, like the sequence. So like the scenes, the order of the scenes. The same way as I told you about Tanya, that I started to film her when she was in the hospital. You know, if I put it in the beginning, we see a weak character. And where does it, you know, like a weak character, it's not really about her. So, okay, I put it somewhere else when we need to see that she works so much, that she's so tired that, you know, it comes out as a disease, as a sickness. Okay, I put it somewhere else. And it doesn't matter that the way you film it, that it must be in the film. No, like it's, you know, like the film, documentary. The film is made in the editing process, and this structure, this dramatic arc evolves there. So try to start with the little scenes and then like develop the story. Here is like the three characteristics what make a good character for the film. So the character, as it says, it has a strong dramatic need. Dramatic need, it's a kind of definition from the script writing books, but basically what it means is that there is something that character wants to achieve, some goal. As we already described in some examples, to find a partner, to, you know, to stay together, to win a lottery, to win the race, and so on and so forth. So, like, there is something that drives your character. Second important thing is that the character has some kind of strong system of belief. They know that they are, for example, in case of Tanya, they are a very dedicated person. I will be with you no matter what happens. I know what is good and bad. I don't know, like some kind of, it can be political views. A person can be racist, you know, very good character. I mean, very bad, but but very good character because the person is, you know, like a racist and he is determined to do, and you can expect him to do certain things. Or it can be a pacifist, or it can be like whatever. And the last thing is there should be like to create this movement, evolvement in the film, there should be some kind of transformation. Something is changing in the lives. And it doesn't, you know, like, something goes from the beginning to end. Something changes. So if you do films about people, you know, like, for example, the elderly people who live their quiet life now and you think nothing changes, it's, the story is in their memories. And you can build this arc, and you can find all these things in how, for example, how they managed to escape from, I don't know, from captivity during the war. How they managed to resolve the transformation. Did they decide to go to join this Galicina army, or did they decide to join the other army? What was driving their decision, and how they distinguished the good from the bad for themselves, and what change did it bring to their life? Yeah, this is quite simple. It's about conflict, that the conflict can be, doesn't really have to be like, you know, a big drama, as we used to say. It doesn't really have to be a war and or something else. It can be something simple, you know, like it can be conflict between people, but it can be internal conflict, that the person has different needs, different points of view, and somehow they need to come to term with these feelings. This is very important, because sometimes we forget to think about style in films, and we tend to, for example, there are two characters in your film. For example, this men who were in different armies, right? And you want to film how they live their lives, their daily lives, just like for the beginning, for the setup of the film. And with one character, you're like this, you know. You're like this, you're following, you're very close, it's like more observational style. And with the other character, you are distance, you put your camera on a tripod, and you see how it will be. But the thing is that when you try to unite both of these footages, it will not really work, because the style is different. In one case, it is observational and very close. In another case, it is distant and more static. So we, as viewers, will not have the same sort of attitude towards these characters, if you want to make them equal. Sometimes it can work, for example, if you want, in films they use, for example, if you want to establish the hierarchy between characters. And one character you film like this, you know, like this. And this character is like, and we know that the character doesn't really have a strength, or like it's in a higher, it's a lower character. And then you film someone from down to up, and this is, you know, like the hero. You can say that this is like the main protagonist, this is whose opinion matters. I gave you just now the example of very basic, like a camera style, but you have to think about different things. You have to think about music, you have to think about the narration, will you use it or not? And also, the most important is to think about how about the visual style of your film. What colors will be more dominant? Will it be color film or not? Will it be like more poetic? Will it be rapid, fast montage? Maybe something else. One of the advices I would like to give you, it refers to your question about Christ and Lenin and the bells, is that you need to remember that you live in a certain context, in a certain culture. It's, for example, it's Europe, Eastern Europe. What does it mean? Europe, that we all somehow come from the ancient Greece, you know? And like somehow this art, Greek drama is close to us. And most of the things that we see now in art, somehow they all date to those times. What else? Christianity. So like, you know, if you say, for example, in this Lenin film, don't take the name of God in vain. Yes, so like, you know, this is from the Bible, everyone can relate here, everyone can relate to this, and you can use it to make your film closer to the people, so that they immediately can connect. It's a very common example. For example, recently I watched a documentary film about China. It was about horrible situation that is in China, coal mines. that people are really struggling, and it's a very hard film, and like this, although the director is Chinese, he had, it's called Behemoth, maybe some of you saw, it's like a masterpiece, but this film had a French producer, and she had this idea, let's make it more, it's like a more Western approach because they, you know, like want to contextualize, but let's make it more understandable. Let's use Dante's Divine Comedy as our literature reference. And so within the film, they had, because, you know, like in this literature work, there are these circles of hell that the person, the main character goes through. And we all know this story. And so they used to break the film into chapters, they used the quotes from this Divine Comedy to somehow make it, you know, like, okay, so this is the hell, this is the circles of the hell. Okay, it immediately clicks into your mind and you can relate. So I think that the most important inspiration are paintings, because cinema is a visual art, and of course literature, because it has so many metaphors, so much richness that we can use in the film. So always try to read, try to think what kind of, you know, like what other films can relate to yours. What, maybe they are similar in topic, maybe they are similar in style. Maybe there are some books which maybe not directly, but somehow reminds you of your film. Maybe it's some even Hollywood film, but somehow which is made similarly. And I would like to show you a short clip, which cause this, there is some enthusiast which compares paintings to the shots made in the films, and to see how cinematographers use paintings as inspiration. We'll watch it. Може хтось світло виключити, будь ласка. Дякую. Yeah, so you like the general maybe advice is that to try to, you know, like to learn art history, to go to different exhibitions, to go to film screening, film festival, to see, you know, like the more references you have, the richer is your cinematic language, and you can choose what your film could look like or not. And remember that film is not a radio, and that's why camera work is important. And this, like these last points that I made, is that, but don't do it as, don't do it as they do it in Brussels. Remember that story is more important. That your if the story is very strong, if you manage to build up a conflict, it doesn't matter if you film it with the cell phone or with like the most expensive camera. If the story holds, it you know, like your film will be good. But if you if you start first to think what kind of new things I would use, like for example, I want to use the latest drone, I want to do this and this and this, you can, yeah, you can. Yes, yes. If you have no story, it will be like visually attractive for 10 minutes, people will like, whoa, like this is super cool. But then they will go out from the film screen with nothing. So be aware of that. Ah, here's a little exercise. So probably you watched this film, no? Like you know what it is. Yeah, Dr. House is like, anyway, so look at this picture and tell me, does it remind you of anything? Oh, good, good, good. Good, 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 good. Okay, so we already have a guess. I think this, you will know. I think this is the most reproduced image in pop culture, classical art, and whatever. We'll look at some other examples. Here. It's by Salvador Dali. Here's Barbie, Lego, whatever, you know? I know it's quite, again, like a cheesy example, but you can see that some references are, you know, like everyone understands them exactly. Also, about these references, storyboard, where does storyboard come from? Yes, it comes from the ancient Greece. If you think about how they were painting their vases, you know, like a vase was some kind of like a comics, a story, a deeds of the hero. For example, this is like the ancient comics. You see the deeds of the hero Tessay. And this was the beginning of the comics and the storyboard, as we now know. So remember of the possible references. Now we will talk about like what kind of types of documentary they can be. These are the first models which come from other non-fictional genres, for example, from from novels, from writing, whatever. So the documentary can be like made as a report, as an investigation. It can be something advocacy, so like something there is a strong cause which drives the film. It can be historical testimony of the witnesses. It can be traveling, natural, geographic, all these kind of styles. Also more scientific, which deals with some subcultures where you would go like for something like an anthropological research. It can be an essay. Very common style of documentary is when it's made as a journal. And we know the journal comes from the, a basic journal where people write what they did, what they think. It can be biographical or autobiographical. So this what documentary took from other non-fictional styles. And this is something the documentary kind of, something new that came only with the documentary films. So first is this expository mode. It's the most common mode in documentary film is when we have a narrator, and narrator tells the story. This happened this, and this, and then happened this. Most of the films that most of the documentary films you saw, they are done in this way. Next one is, by the way, I wanted to tell you, so this is taken from a book by Bill Nicholson. It's called The Introduction to Documentary Films, and he's kind of theorizing on different kind of different kinds of documentary. So the next one is poetic. Poetic, it began, the poetic documentaries began in 1920s when people, artists were fed up with this expository mode, when there is, you know, like the voice of God who tells the story, and they wanted to experiment. It was also in time with the avant-garde modernist movement, and basically they tried to get rid of this basic structure of a narrator and to think more in a visual way. Some patterns, some colors, which would some sounds, some noises, which would guide us through the film. I wanted to, it's not so easy to understand if you haven't really seen it. So I wanted to show a short excerpt so that it's like what you will see now. It's pure poetic, although these models could be mixed. Sometimes people say, "Oh, this film is poetic." What does it mean? Maybe it has, you know, like a, it's not that strict poetic, but sometimes it has some elements. We are driven by some, maybe some abstract images, some noises. But I will show you a pure poetic film now, part. Very often these poetic films, maybe you know, like a symphony of the city. Different cities, they had like this film about how the city works, how the city lives. So this is an example of this. Oh, it's in New York, New York. So you got the impression, sorry, it was maybe a bit too long, but I just wanted to know you to notice that maybe it looks very abstract, very strange, but actually it has a very clear structure. We watched the act one, so it's like New York, the city is waking up, we see the buildings, we see this and that, and then the plot point one, the alarm clock. And then rinse, and then we know what the story will be about. So it's a kind of like a day in the city. And you see, even in this hyper abstract film, which you might think it is, it's very, very clear how it will be, how it will be developed. So observational style, I think you are all familiar with this. The first observational films, they started like in about 50s, 60s, when it was possible, when with the camera, so that you didn't have a big camera that you have to, you know, like to transport only with the car, but you have a little camera which can record the sound and the image synchronously, and you can follow the character wherever. Observational style you saw, for example, in the film about Tanya is most of the time is observational, and also about Oksana, although it mixes the expository mode and the observational. Participatory is when the filmmaker is part of the film, and the filmmaker doesn't hide that she or he is present behind the camera, but maybe it's an important character, maybe it's a film about family relations, and the presence and the reaction of the filmmaker is important. Reflexive is, I think, the least represented within documentary films. Reflexive mode means that you as a filmmaker question the film itself, how it's made, how we as filmmakers create it, and we kind of don't hide behind the camera, but we make it visible how we manipulate the film. And maybe the most famous example is this man with the movie camera by Dzigo Vertov, the classics, when you remember, like, he's filming, he's shown as he's filming, and then we see his wife, who is editing, and how she puts maybe shots from different places, but to one place, and they say that, oh, okay, this is not really how it happened, we kind of made it happen for you. So this is the reflexive. And performative is something which stresses people's experience, something. Usually this mode is used when with emotional films, when we really want viewers to feel what the character go through in their lives. And very often this mode is used for films which are made about different subcultures. For example, gay or lesbian subculture, minority subcultures, when we really kind of want the viewers to step in their shoes and to make them, even like the films about Holocaust survivors, very personal films, they also make a strong empathical contact, and we sort of experience, by watching the film, we experience ourselves how these people might feel. So this is some references. I recommend you this book, Screenplay in the Middle by Sid Field. It's like very basic, but about script writing, if you're interested to know more about how to develop the character and the conflict. The first one is Bill Nichols' Introduction to Documentary, where he theorizes about different kind of documentary films. And this is Directing Documentary by Michael Rappiger, if you're interested to know. It's like more general introduction to documentary films. And one thing which relates about style, which I wanted to talk about, is about the limitations. That sometimes it's very important to set the artistic limitations to yourself. I know it's hard to read, but it's not so important. This is, maybe you've heard about Dogma, group Dogma. So Dogma was formed in 95. It's a group of filmmakers. The most famous of them was Lars von Trier. And they made this group, and they said that we want pure cinema. And they said, so this is, if you want to join our group, if you support our collective, you need to follow the certain rules when you do films. For example, the sound can never be produced somewhere else. Sound has to be recorded in the place where it is happening. You cannot use music. You cannot use any kind of effect. You cannot use, for example, black and white film just to make it look somehow more artistic. Use what technology is available and much more. And sometimes it is very important for you in the beginning of thinking about your film to set these limitations for yourself. For example, I will use only handheld camera. I will not use tripod. Or for example, vice versa. I want good static shots, so only tripod, no, nothing else. For example, maybe you know about School of Documentary in Moscow, which is quite famous, Marina Razbezhkina School. And they, for their students, in the very beginning of education, they say, we have these rules. And when you do works within the school, you need only to follow these rules. So you cannot, some of them, if I remember correctly. So first of all, you cannot use Zoom. If you want to get a closer shot, you go and like make a contact with the person. And not, you know, like hide somewhere and Zoom, I see her.
Well, it is necessary because optical
possibility. Yes, for example, good, just the, you can, you know, use this limitation. So you, then they don't allow to use any music. Because music, you know, it sets emotional mode, and maybe you don't get these emotions from watching the film, but just because there is a music, and it works. But otherwise, film would not work. So no music, no voiceover. If you want no interviews, no voiceover. You cannot just, you know, like make an interview and illustrate with some shots, but you need to find a situation where the person would tell some story, and it would be a live story. There is some more, but basically, yes, so try to think if you need some limitations or not. And sometimes limitations can be very helpful, because at the very beginning you know how you would film and which techniques you would not try, and it will, although it might seem that it's not so good for you, but actually it gives you other possibilities, and your film becomes more structured. Again, like start with the references, start with the films which deal thematically, which are similar to your topic, or which are similar by style to what you want to achieve. And now I propose that we watch a couple films, excerpts from a couple films which deal with the witnesses of the dramatic events in the 20th century. So maybe you get some ideas how the films could be made. Okay, and then we discuss how they were made.
No, I just wanted to ask you how much do you use limitations during your films, or is it just like when you have a project and you think, oh, maybe in this project I will use these limitations, or maybe in another project I will use everything that I'm able to use. So what are your approaches?
Usually in the beginning I set limitations. Okay, I want a beautiful picture only tripod. And then when I know, like when I face the, it's sometimes for me, I'm not so, I'm not really so strong with the limitations in terms that sometimes I break, or sometimes I create limitations because I see that the film only will work this way. For example, in this The Fall of Lenin film. At first, I was going to use interviews, different situations with the characters, some observational style, but then I said, no, just the archives and this little end which I need for, this little shooting which I need for the ending. That's it. And then, you know, like if I, now film works, but maybe if it would be like this and that, this character, this style, it would be like a chaos. So yes, so you can set the limitations in the beginning, in the middle, in the end. The best if you start in the beginning and you try to keep up with this and it works. But you know, you have to also be flexible, I think.
Sounds like when you're doing research and try to find your method, like do I use a information protocol like a sheet, or do I do an interview and ask questions? Is it going to be
Yes.
How do I get my
data?
Is it kind of like that?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. It doesn't really have to be only related to like techniques that you use, some stylistic things, but also like the method how you're going to approach your films. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. So let's watch some excerpts. Uh, Okay, so maybe just a very short introduction. So the first film is called 48. It was made in Portugal, and the backstory is that in Portugal, maybe you know, maybe not, there was the longest fascist dictatorship in Western Europe. It was Salazar. He was ruling the country for 48 years, so that's why it's called 48.
Preso em casa a primeira vez e a segunda vez foi preso na companhia. Aquilo devia estar a fazer muitas prisões nesse dia. Levaram-me de elétrico. Queriam que eu pagasse o bilhete. E eu comecei a falar alto, era o que faltava, sou preso e ainda tenho que pagar o bilhete. Esta fotografia. Pois é, é assim, exatamente. Por debaixo do sobretudo tem um blusão. É exatamente isso. Por debaixo do sobretudo tem um blusão. E portanto, se vou levar muita pancada, peraí, deixa-me vestir a preceito. Isto é uma coisa pateta, porque evidentemente eles se quiserem despir, despem-nos. Mas aquela coisa, portanto, eu vou levar aí umas boas pancadas, mas estou protegido. Esta não me lembro. O que para mim é estranho é que isto é uma fotografia tirada na polícia. Sou eu. Mas não me lembro nada.
So I understand sometimes it can be hard to watch such film, but and this film lasts about 1.5 hours. But it's like really, if you get into this mood, slow narration, and you see it's very minimalistic style, just the photos. What is also interesting that these photos were made by police, so the. The purpose of these photos was to identify the enemies of the country, so to say. So these photos were used against these people. But it is interesting that in this film, the director, she changes the strategy. The photos are made to show about dictatorship, to show about these policemen, about the guards and how they were torturing people. So the film is comprised of many stories which are done in this way, just these photographs, and they are talking about their experience. But it is interesting that you see how rich their language is and their stories. And it's not something which is chronological. They arrested me on this day, I did this, and then this. But and also you can use this in your film. Sometimes a photograph can provoke memories. And very interesting situation. And you take, you pay attention to some details. You see, like I was wearing a jacket under a coat, how stupid it is, but this was made to protect yourself. And through these little details, which you think at first are not important, we can actually feel much more. We can feel how maybe they were afraid, how they were trying to hide themselves. This the second woman, she talks a lot about this deprivation of privacy, and her whole story is based on this sensuality. This no one, there was no sincerity, because in fascist regime you are deprived to very strict rules, and there is no intimacy, no sincerity, and there is no relations to within people, and this is how the system tries to destroy you. So you see, like, you can do a film with a very minimalistic visual approach, and this film got one of the best Portuguese films. It got many awards in different festivals, and it's really, if you have time, it's really worth watching the whole film. I want to show you another. One of my favorite films. It also uses archive footage, which is available to everyone, and uses the archive footage, which the main purpose was propaganda for it, but it deconstructs the meaning. I have a question. Should I make the excerpts shorter, or like how is it going? It's okay? Yeah. Because, you know, like, it's important to get in the mood, and it's not so easy if we can only see little parts of the film.
Selbst war Künstler und hätte mich gern aus der Politik herausgehalten.
I was an artist and wished to retire from politics altogether. The only things that endure are the works of human genius. This is why I loved art.
Mein Gott war Wagner.
To me, Wagner was God. His music was my religion. I loved moving pictures, especially the American ones. Lives of a Bengal Lancer was my favorite. I saw it three nights running. And of course, I loved the ones that...
A good point, yes. Badan is saying that he didn't really like the Russian narration, which was made for Stalin, because it's not a proper way to pronounce names. So the film was made by an American filmmaker, and this is his style to make strange montage films. He collects all kind of archive footage from everywhere. Some things people even threw away, he collects, somehow categorizes, and then he has these even stranger ideas. To put these different footages in some kind of structure which makes sense for him. Does anyone want to reflect some comments about this film? How did it make you feel?
I think
about our topic, about history, about to do this so таким чином, щоб інші люди ну не сказали нам, що це взагалі. Ну розуміють, наскільки це масова така форма, вона складна для сприйняття.
To understand this, yes, but this is, it's, you know, I am trying to show you different, completely different styles so that you can see what is possible.
It has aftertaste.
And what is your aftertaste? Tell me.
I like sound. One note, one.
And like very kind of, it keeps you like, oh. Yes. So also this is the part of the film. The film deals with the, I just chose this because, you know, like it's more relative to, relevant to us.
Is this sound of a plane?
I don't know. It can be, but it's very good that this film made you feel so. Because it can be any kind of sound, you know? But the way that you associated it with the airplane, so the war and like what these people were involved to, it gives this, I mean, it works. Then it means that it works. But what is important in this film, that again, like this footage is a pure propaganda footage. Oh, look, our leader, how great, how cool, how powerful. And what the filmmaker does is that he, you know, he doesn't make him powerful, he makes him, yes, human remains. And this is maybe, maybe you know Hannah Arendt and her work Banality of Evil, yes? That we think, oh, these fascists, you know, like, oh, it was so planned, they all were so evil, cruel, whatever. I'm not making moral judgment, just like, you know, the idea of this work of her, but the fact is that all the people who were involved in these structures, they were simply doing their job as they explain it. And again, it's not a moral judgment. We can have our own attitudes. And the idea of this film is to play this banality of the evil. Although we all know who these people are, what they did, and like it's really, I don't know, it. When I first watched this film, it really kind of made me uncomfortable because I sometimes feel compassion for them and I'm empathical and I'm like, no, you know? And but then we do. I think, like, did you feel something like this? Did you feel that, you know, it's a person, not just, you know, what we categorized as the dictator, the, you know, the devil or whatever. Did you feel something?
You kind of start laughing. And I think this was also, like, a way to destroy this godlike situation and to make fun of this.
Yeah. Yeah, it has some funny moments, some more dramatic, and also it's very good that they kept this sound, that it's kind of, although you, sometimes you feel empathy, no, it brings you back, like, okay, the distance. But I don't know how you experienced this film, but it was kind of, very interesting for me to, follow my emotions while I watch the film. And yeah, so this is one of the ways you can think of your film. Take this, I don't know, footage about collectivization. You were talking about it yesterday, so this was done to show the power, the might of the Soviet Union, but you can put another narration which tells the story of Holodomor. And you see, like, take these footages of this powerful Soviet Union. We produce steel, we produce products, this and this and this. The factories are working, and then the background story is the story of that we didn't have anything. We didn't have to, clothes to wear or food to eat. Just, you know, like to try to break the initial message, which was the base of this footage, and make your own. Yeah?
You probably know about the projects of Anton Boybukov, and he does actually the same, but with music.
Yes.
He takes some old propagandist movies and write a new scores for it.
Yes, you can play. Yes. You can play with the sound. You can, like, use one sound just to post contrasting pictures, or the other way around. In this way, the sound, analogy with Baibakov was in the words. Like, the words had completely different meaning from what the picture was saying. Вікторія, how much time do we have?
Ну, ми ще можемо так 10 хвилин поспілкуватися, а тоді будемо переходити обідати і там продовжувати.
Up to 10 minutes and then the lunch.
Okay, so we can talk or I can show you another excerpt and we will talk about, discuss it later. What do you feel?
Man with the camera, Optigoverto, you said that it is
reflexive.
Reflexive. Mm-hmm. Yes. But if Anton Bebekov had music there and it came not a silent movie and movie, but it became the second
of a poetic.
Poetry.
Yes. Again, like this classification is classification made by this scholar, and it has very strict categories. But in real life, all of them mix. There is some more of this, some more of that style, or one style is more dominant than the others. But it's just like for you to know that there are different. Say it again. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, like connect. So let's watch now, and then we can discuss, or you can think about later. Some films are character driven, like you find the character and through the character you tell the story, and some things are more like topic driven. You have a topic and you have an idea, and then you try to find characters who would fit into your topic. And this is an example of a topic-driven film. It's called Cooking History. It is done by Slovak film director Peter Kerekes, and his idea was to find different military cooks from different countries and to show how they worked and to tell the story of the war through what they were doing and through their memories.
Какой хлеб самый лучший в мире?
Черный, потому что он сытный и полезный.
Ты все фронты Европы прошли, много хлеба покушала. В какой стране, какая нация лучше всего хлеб печет?
Да, наверное, одинаково везде пекут. Хлеб есть хлеб. Невзирая на нации.
Erinnert ihr euch noch an den Kommiss bzw. an das Brot, das wir gebacken haben im Krieg? Es duftete beim Anschnitt und anregend zum Hineinbeißen und das Brot im Mund sitzen, verkauen lassen.
It's a pity that we had to take just a little part, but basically different cooks from different countries, Soviet Union, Germany, Israel, there is also from the Balkan conflict, from war in Chechnya, they talk about, so basically they talk about their craft, how they would cook, and it's good that if you communicate with people, what you ask about, not like abstract questions, but also about things that they are certain of how to do and what to do. And also if they're doing in the process, they, you know, like really experts in something. So anyway, so this is the approach. But basically, they tell the story of all the conflicts and also from kind of it's bread, everyone needs to eat. There is not that much more judgment. You see that how the shots from different countries are juxtaposed. And I think it also makes us feel empathy for all the characters regarding of their origin. Yeah, so I think that's it. And the rest we continue, if you want, in an informal atmosphere.